would think that we couldn't possibly have a problem with storing our stuff, but how many of us with two-car garages can actually park two cars in a garage? It's for this reason that 1 out of 10 Americans rent off-site storage, and why there are upward of 50,000 storage facilities and 1.3 square feet of storage space for every man, woman, and child in the United States. Now, having said that, inevitably, we need to move the stuff that we store. And how can we move our stuff? Well, let's count the ways. There are pods or containers. You drive trucks. Overhead containers, air, ship, cars, or pickup trucks. As a matter of fact, there's a new kind of a Uber sort of thing you can rent. Joe's pickup truck for the afternoon. Know that entrepreneurial spirit. The moving industry is changing before our eyes. It seems like almost every day we hear about new startups that are making it easier, cheaper, and more innovative to move our stuff. That's similar to what Amazon did with the publishing industry and then with retail. And the impact that Uber is having on the taxi cab industry. Entrepreneurs are aiming to disrupt the moving industry as well. Now, while new technology is one driver of change, there are larger shifts in society that are driving different expectations for service. What we move and the ways we choose to move, those things are also within flux. For example, on-demand storage companies like Closet Box and Clutter give people the option to outsource their storage needs versus the traditional self-storage model. These companies will pick up your stuff, haul it away, store it, and bring it back when you need it. There's also on-demand transportation and labor companies that specialize in small moves or like delivering furniture that was purchased at a local store or even via Craigslist. King David had a storage problem. And he had a moving problem as well. The storage problem was that the Philistines had the Ark of the Covenant, which properly belonged to Israel. It wasn't right that the enemy of Israel had the ark in storage. Now he had a moving problem because he had some stuff, some really holy stuff, in which he needed to move. He had to move the ark from the control of the Philistines to his new genocide capital of David and his people had one job to do. One job to do, and they screwed it up. You don't move God in an ox cart. Now, the Philistines had used a cart to send the ark, and David merely opted with what they had done. What was he thinking? At this point, I think it's important to ask the question, what exactly is the ark? We need to find that out because the word is not in common use in everyday English. The word is, in effect, archaic. And we don't often, but when we do recognize it, what comes to mind, first of all? No one in the ark, and all those aspects. We assume that the ark is really just a big boat. The ark was basically the home stone tablets of the Ten Commandments, the rod of Aaron, as well as a golden pot of manna. Now, the instructions for transporting this ark were very specific. It was always covered in a certain way with skins and with a blue cloth. It was virtually concealed as it was moved from one location to another. Throughout those 40 years of wandering, every day they broke camp and covered that ark with skins and this special blue cloth. The transportation people, entrusted with the job of moving the God in the ark, were the Levites, and particularly the priestly class. There's nothing in there but an ox. As for its size, it was about the size of a large trunk, maybe 4 feet by 3 feet by 2 feet, something like that, give or take. It was carried by means of two poles, threaded through some brass rings on either side, and porters carried it, much like a seti for a Far East potentate. And it had a history. It was linked to a number of miracles. When the Israelites crossed the Jordan before entering into the Promised Land for the first time, the waters of the Jordan parted as the Red Sea had parted decades earlier during the seminal event we know as the Exodus. As the Israelites moved into the Promised Land, they encountered a formidable resistance in Jericho. Priests carried the ark around the city for a week, and on the seventh day, the walls came down. This was the beginning of the ark's association with military success, and it became a sort of a military talisman or mascot. And now as we look at this text, the ark which had been captured by the Philistines was now about to be returned to its true home. Like a trophy being returned to the city to which it belonged. Israel had suffered a crushing defeat at the hands of the Philistines, and it concluded that their loss was due to the absence of the ark. In 1 Samuel 4:3, we read, "Why has the Lord put us to rout today before the Philistines? Let us bring the Ark of the Covenant to the Lord, Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, here from Shiloh, so that he may come among us and save us from the power of our enemies." So they brought the Ark to the battle, to no avail. But the Philistines, although fearful of the presence of Israel's sacred relic, they rallied. And in the subsequent battle, they subsequently defeated the Israelites. They lost 30,000 soldiers. The ark, too, was captured. And two of Eli's sons died. Now, years have passed, and the leadership of Israel fell to Samuel, and then to their first king, Saul, and then to David. And when David was anointed king, the Philistines were hunting for him. David met them, and the armies of Israel defeated the Philistines without the ark. David then gathered 30,000 men to retrieve the Ark of the Covenant from the Philistines and to bring it to Jerusalem. And he put it in a new cart. And the procession began, accompanied with music and dancing, but the cart hit a problem. It must have been close to 4 minutes. And Uzzah, walking beside the cart, reached out to steady the cart. Actually, out of devotion. starting to death. Because he had dared touch the garden of God. Now this definitely spoiled the ark. And the ark went no further. It was placed in the hands of a certain Obed-Edom, and there it stayed for 3 months. And this family was blessed because of the presence of the Ark of the Covenant. And seeing how God had blessed Obed-Edom, David decides to move the Ark again, and this time he does it right. So how do we move God? The answer is very carefully. What can we learn from all of this? First of all, we want God's presence with us as we journey through life. David had moved his capital to Jerusalem, and he wanted to move God. He wanted God to be where he was. The presence of the Ark of the Covenant in Jerusalem was ceremonially and symbolically significant. Who doesn't want God to go with them and to be with them throughout their life? We all do. And if we're faithful Christians, we are anxious not to make any big decisions or changes in our lives unless we feel that that is in the will of God. David's desire to have the ark moved to Jerusalem was a good one. Our hope is that God will be with us through all of the events of our lives. That too is a good desire. God does not want us to be alone. And we are not. Secondly, God does not need protecting. Let's not presume to speak for God, set God right, or to move God back into some proper and safe position. The God who needs our protection is no God at all. And we then assume God-like duties ourselves. Often we feel as though we need to speak up to God against what we consider to be destructive errors or doctrinal mistakes, cultural misconceptions, and so on and so forth. Perhaps there's nothing wrong with this, but we should probably use a great deal of caution when speaking to God. My knees rattle and shake when I read texts that say, "Thus saith the Lord." That should give everyone cause and cause. Thirdly, God is in the details. David learned quickly that there is a right way and a wrong way. Sometimes our motives might be pure, and our intentions laudable. But the methodology leaves something to be desired. We're patient. When patience is called for. We're unkind when kindness would be better. We're stubborn when flexibility is needed. And we're more inclined to talk than we should be listening. Fourthly, David learned that it wasn't all about him. It's not all about us either. In the first attempt, he travels with a huge entourage as king. And in the second, he's wearing the same robes as the priests. Fifthly, we must follow scripture. In his second attempt, David does it right. He makes elaborate preparations to bring the ark from Obed-Edom's house. And in the first attempt, he had a committee. They all voted yes. finally, David's first plan failed. But that was not the end of the story. And David was not a person who gave up. He recognized that a failure was simply a step on the path to ultimate success. We all fail at something. But a failure is not the end, but rather the beginning of something new. And with a failure, we have a chance to go back to square one and to do something entirely different, or to tweak it and massage our first efforts until we get it right. This morning we are installing elders and deacons. And of the session, the elders of the session, I periodically remind them that they are the deliberative body of this church. They provide the leadership of this church. And they make decisions. And once they make a decision, it's close ranks and move forward in that direction. And if in 6 months' time or whatever, we discover that, gee, it just didn't work out the way we had anticipated, we could have a tool. We could modify, we could change, we could drop a particular motion or tweak. The truth of the matter is we really don't need a move count. Rather, we really want to be in a frame of mind in which we're willing to let God move us. As Aristotle noted, God is the unmoved mover, or the prime mover. God has never been moved. It is God who does the move. It's not about us moving God, it's about God moving us. Let's be willing for God to move us when, how God wants to move us. The lovingness of God, humble us for the thing that you would guide and direct us, that we might yield ourselves, our lives, and our corporate life to the various Father, the Son, and the Spirit. In spirit,